All right, let's talk about right-sizing the bureaucracy. We have with us Marikina Representative Stella Kimbo. Good morning to you, Congresswoman Kimbo.
Good morning, Karen, and to all your viewers.
All right, it's estimated that more than 2 million members of the government will be affected with what the Department of Budget and Management calls right-sizing. First of all, do you agree in general with the concept of streamlining the bureaucracy?
Well, as an economist, Karen, I completely believe in the idea of having an optimal size of a government. So right now, we're talking about right-sizing. We're not talking about downsizing. So we're not necessarily only going to talk about downsizing, because there could be situations, Karen, like in some government agencies, na kulang naman ang plantilla positions. Mm-mm. So remember, ultimately, although ang na-emphasize talaga dito is really the savings that can be had from reducing the number of positions. But for me, really, the bigger benefit is really the efficient delivery of services. Karen, as a taxpayer, may mga situations na pupunta tayo sa isang government agency, nagtataka tayo, teka muna, bakit ang dami-daming nag-aasikaso? Or at the same time, in situations naman na it's the complete opposite, nakulang ang nag-aasikaso sa'yo. So, it's about time na pag-aralan na talaga kung saan kulang or kung saan sobra naman. Mm-hmm. And so yun, for me, that's the idea of right-sizing. It's really the optimal size of government.
Okay. Now, while, of course, this is commendable, it does affect economic recovery also with the personal lives of those in government. We're talking about pandemic recovery for their families as well. How do you balance that?
Well, absolutely. That's a very, very important concern. So obviously, economic recovery, the main focus is job creation. So mag tayo dito sa job destruction. So, well, first of all, this won't happen overnight. Kailangan pag-aralan na mabuti. And number two, we have to keep in mind that as we abolish, if we need to abolish, we need to minimize displacement among workers. And how to do that? I mean, there are tools, for example, like early retirement. Okay. So in other words, for positions that are outdated, chances are, Karen, mga senior na siguro mga nakaupo dyan, the fact na nag-obsolete na siya, outdated, malamang medyo may katandaan ng nakaupo dyan. So pwede naman natin either hintayan ng retirement or alokin ng early retirement. Mm-mm. Or in a situation where medyo mabata pa yung nakaupo sa isang obsolete na position na tatanggalin, pwede natin alokin ng retooling programs. So that's the reason for why hindi tayo pwedeng padalos-dalos. Right-sizing would require also putting in the necessary safety nets so that we don't displace workers, especially today, that we really need to create jobs.
Okay. And Congresswoman, what about contractuals in government? Do you have an estimate of just how many do you believe will be affected?
Well, okay. First of all, again, the reason for why we have a lot of job orders or contractuals in government is because we have not really sat down and thought about the correct number of staff positions in government. So ang dahilan kung bakit we end up hiring consultants is because hindi available yung plantilla position or napakahirap humingi ng plantilla position sa DBM. Mm-hmm. So yun eh, parang chicken and an egg thing eh. So tingin ko, if we do right sizing and then we make a determination, agency X needs X plantilla positions at ito ang skill set na kailangan, ito yung specific staff position, full-time, part-time, etc. Hindi na, mami-minimize din natin ang need for consultants. But as of now, so meron tayong close to 2 million na plantilla positions, pero tama ka, Karen, marami pang consultants kasi yon naman ay naka-charge under MOOE. Unfortunately, I don't have the exact number, pero tingin ko if 28% ang share ng personnel services sa total budget, tingin ko if you put in the mga consultants and JO, baka umabot pa sa 40% ang share ng total salaries for manpower.
Mm-mm. The term right-sizing, it's sending mixed signals to different parts of government. And I'll tell you one. The DOLE Secretary, Labor Secretary Bienvenido Laguesma, already announced that in plans to right-size the government, there will be no retrenchment. It does not automatically mean retrenchment. But if you right-size, it would mean some would have to be removed. So would not that be equal to retrenchment?
I guess if our workers opt for early retirement or mandatory retirement, that's not technically retrenchment. So I think papunta doon, palagay ko. I mean, that's the way to reconcile both statements.
Uh-oh. And the announcement is roughly 5%. The aim is actually to remove just 5% of redundant government positions. Would you consider this number accurate, Congresswoman, considering you said earlier we haven't even determined just which positions we need?
To be honest, Karen, I think it's a little bit premature to say it's 5%, 6%. Uh-oh. First step talaga, what's the baseline situation? We have not done an inventory of staff position. And hindi lang ito pagbibilang, ito yung dami ng staff position. Mm-hmm. Hindi eh, kailangan ka mag-time and motion studies eh. Kung ito ang mandato ng isang ahensya, these are the number of approvals that need to be done in X number of months, et cetera, et cetera. Then you make a determination, ilang tao ang kailangan ko. Saka ka babalik at sasabihin, ay, teka muna, sobra pala ako ng tao. Or kulang ako ng tao for that matter. Mm-hmm. So, hindi natin alam eh. So, may mga ahensya na malamang, baka nga mag-increase pa ang staff position. So, halimbawa, remember, very important na mag-digital pivot ang ating gobyerno. And at this point in time, malamang kulang ang staff positions na merong ganong klaseng skill set. So, malamang magdadagdag tayo ng ganong klaseng staff position. But what's the net effect? Karen, it's very hard to say at this point in time. So ang tingin ko, wag natin i-preempt. Ang importante is, nandyan ang political will to do this. Bata pa lang ako na teacher, Karen, sa UP, lahat na ng mga policy researchers, ito na talaga ang panukala that we really need to right-size the bureaucracy. It can be bloated. So it's a very good opportunity. Nandyan ang political will, nandyan ang political capital ng ating Pangulo. So sana gamitin lang mabuti para finally magawa na itong very important reform.
Okay, so the savings of 14.8 billion that they've announced so far, let's be honest, we're not seeing that in the next year or even in the next 2 years?
I doubt that, Karen, kasi tandaan natin, no, meron tayong GOCC Act na pinasa noong 2011. And one of the mandates of the GCG is precisely to right-size the GOCCs. Eh, fast forward to today, 11 years after, out of 180 GOCCs, apat pa lang nare-right-size.
Oh, wow.
So, may
kabagala. That's really...
Yeah. So, but it's a different situation today, Karen. Pag nandiyan ang political will, babalangkasan ng Pangulo na importante ito, lalagyan ng pondo, kasi very important yung budget. Diba? Saan ka kukuha ng pera para maggawa ng early retirement program? Kailangan mong pondohan yan. So kung nandun ang necessary ingredients, palagay ko naman mas mabilis tayo sa GCG sa pag-right-size.
Okay, so that's one. Political will is a big issue. The track record so far with GOCCs has been very slow and very poor in terms of the speed of actually right-sizing. What about certain agencies that have been quite controversial in the past few years in the 18th Congress that even some senators and congresswomen like yourself have said to remove this? Let's talk about certain attached agencies. For example, how many are you seeing that should be considered to be removed immediately?
Again, Karen, it's very difficult to make that to make any assessment. Pero ako, I've said, for example, I've said this many times in public and I've been very vocal about it. Like PhilHealth, which is an attached agency to DOH. Talagang alam natin, very inefficient ang pag-deliver ng services nila. And I had over and over again recommended that we can outsource from the private sector certain functions, no? So the question there is, anong ibig sabihin nun? Kukunti ba ang empleyado sa PhilHealth? Well, not necessarily, again. Kasi pag tinanong mo ang PhilHealth, ilan bang abogado mo? Kasi para tugisin lahat ng mga unscrupulous ng mga partners, ang kaunti, di ba? So baka naman on one hand, pwede mong bawasan in certain operating segments na pwede mong outsource sa private sector. On the other hand, dadamihan mo naman doon sa segments na kulang ang tao mo.
Mm-mm.
So again, very difficult to talk about the net effect at this point in time.
Oo. But then for example, that's one. And then offices like, for example, PITC, PSDBM. I mean, I'm unsure just how many personnel there would be in those specific offices. Do you believe that would help? That should be much faster?
I guess the question kasi is, do we appreciate the mandate of certain agencies?
Yeah.
So obviously, PSDBM naging controversial. But if you ask me, ha, maganda naman yung idea eh. Maganda yung idea na tutulungan ng PSDBM ang mga ahensya to procure. Kaya nagtrabaho ako sa gobyerno buong buhay ko. Talagang laking ahensya ako. Napakahirap talaga mag-procure under very archaic procurement laws. So maganda sana yung, ang mandato ng PSDBM. So ang tingin ko, ang question doon is...
Kaso naabuso.
Naabuso. So baka ang tingin ko, ang sagot doon is transparency. Kapag transparent talaga ang methods, naka-livestream siya, nanonood ang publiko, nanonood ang media, may CCTV, eh palagay ko talagang mababawasan dyan ang, if ever, no, ang hindi magandang gawain.
Mm-hmm.
So, having said that, huwag natin i-preempt yung question on how many people will be removed from those agencies.
Oo.
Ang tingin ko, balikan ang mandato, paano gagawin ang mandato sa isang mabuting paraan, magandang paraan, mabilis na paraan, and next question, ilang tao ang kailangan mo?
And ang controversial dito niyan, Congresswoman, is who determines which positions are not needed, which agencies can be let go of. Who determines that? Is it just the secretary? Should it be like a specific body? Sino po yun?
I think it has to be in different levels. Pagdating sa dami ng plantilla positions within an agency, kasi galing nga ako sa ahensya, kaya yun ng head eh. And iniisip ng mga tao, hindi, matagal yan. Alam mo, hindi. Doon sa karanasan namin sa Philippine Competition Commission. It was a new commission. I was one of the founding commissioners. And ang nangyari doon, when we started, binigay na sa amin yung dami ng plantilla positions. So it was already a fixed number of plantilla positions, even when at that point in time, we did not have yet a clear understanding of how to execute our function because we needed to build our capacity, etc. And then maybe 1 year later, we realized that we needed a certain number, a correct number of plantilla positions. But at that point in time, it was too late. It was very difficult to get plantilla positions from DBM. So tingin ko yun ang nangyayari. Pag nakikreate ang isang ahensya, nagkakaroon ng parang assumed number of positions, as meaning assumed that will support the mandate. But... hindi naman yun pala yung kailangan. So, yun ang nangyayari over time. Kaya hindi, malamang sa malamang, hindi correct ang number ng plantilla position sa bawat ahensya.
Oo. Now, would privatization help? One example I've heard in the last few days is the question of why not privatize PAGCOR, for example, other than, of course, it might be more profitable. Would that actually be a factor in streamlining government?
Well, they have to be, so the use of technology and right-sizing of the bureaucracy, they really have to come hand in hand.
Mm-hmm.
So nandyan ang digital pivoting. Like, for example, if you remember, Karen, in our distribution of ayuda, we had great difficulty distributing ayuda because that was done manually.
Uh-oh.
So at this point in time, kailangan na siguro tayo mag-pivot to digital, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the question there is, paano yun? Paano yung mga tao na hired for that purpose? Well, yun na nga, kailangan pag-aralan. So saan yung better use of that manpower? Or kung medyo bata-bata sila, baka pwedeng ma-retool so that they can occupy other positions.
Okay, let's talk about now the 2023 national budget. Incoming, I'd like to say incoming, but let's put it to the most likely. The Speaker of the House in the 19th Congress, Congressman Romualdez, says that he is eyeing that the 2023 national budget is actually approved by the end of the year. Are you seeing this as a possibility, ma'am?
Absolutely. That can be done. Depende lang talaga sa leadership, and if that these are the pronouncements of incoming speaker, naniniwala ako. And kung naalala ninyo sa canvassing, halos hindi tumayo si Kong Martin sa kanyang upuan because he really wanted to work within a certain timeline. So nakikita ko na the same effort and energy level ay talagang exert niya para patuparin yan. Mm-mm. And number two, tingin ko, Karen, dapat magpalit na tayo ng mindset na imbis na tagalan natin ang pag-deliberate ng budget, baka maglaan tayo ng panahon para i-monitor ang execution ng budget after approval. Mm. So imbis na yung buong taon ang pinag-uusapan natin is approval, maglaan tayo ng panahon para i-monitor ang execution because doon tayo medyo pumapalpak.
Oo.
Kahit na maganda ang pag-approve natin, nilakihan natin halimbawa ang budget on mental health at a certain point, nilakihan natin ang budget on bakuna, pero in the end, hindi natin nagagastos because nakukulangan na tayo ng panahon para i-monitor ang execution. So maganda, napakaganda ng pronouncement ni incoming Speaker Martin na tapusin natin kaagad so that we have a few months para naman ang laanan ng atensyon is execution.
Okay, the Department of Finance recommended prior to President Marcos coming in that the increase for the 2023 budget would only be something like 200, I believe it was something like 200 billion, right? Is it retained at 200 billion, Congresswoman?
Well, to be honest, hindi ko pa alam because we have yet to hear a formal pronouncement from the DBCC. But again, para sa akin, Karen, it's really, and we've seen this in the last 2 years during the pandemic, ang nagiging problema in the end is not really how much we put in for pandemic response.
It's how to spend.
It's really how to spend. And many agencies would say, hindi namin, I mean, okay, pero hindi namin kaya. So, babalik tayo sa right sizing, di ba? So, baka naman sa sobrang bloated ng bureaucracy, napakabagal ng takbo niya, kumbaga sa bus. Masyadong maraming pasahero, napakabagal ng takbo ng bus. Mm-hmm. So, again, babalik tayo sa right sizing. So, very important to do it now.
Okay. Now, the State of the Nation address is next week. What would you want to hear with President Marcos's SONA?
Well, economic recovery, obviously, and he said it many times. He's talked about very important issues. Key issues would be inflation, food inflation particularly, and the high cost of electricity. Pero sa akin, overall, Karen, ang maganda sanang marinig is yung structural reforms na matagal na natin pinopostpone because wala tayong masyadong political capital. Uh-oh. But with 31 million votes, parang I'm very hopeful and with a very good set of economic managers na matagal na rin naman nilang pinaglalaban bilang ekonomista ang maraming structural reforms, tingin ko pakaya ng pwedeng gawin.
Oo.
Kasama
and,
dyan,
and can you
online,
share, can
example,
you be specific, Congresswoman, on certain structural reforms that you believe would make a difference in the next 6 years?
So first of all, we really need to do something about our agriculture sector.
Yeah.
So our farmers are really very inefficient. And so now, ang hirap eh, because we need to bring down the prices of food. The only way to do that is to, at this point, in the short run, is to bring in cheaper imported food items. Pero syempre when you do that, you displace naman our local producers. So ang hirap talaga. So once and for all, tugunan na natin yan. Kailangan na natin talagang ayudahan ng farmers so that they are able to have more efficient production methods.
Uh-oh.
Kasama dyan, because of agri, is yung land. Yung Land Use Act na isang priority bill under the Duterte administration, hindi na ipasa eh. Isa yan sa kakaunti na hindi na ipasa. Because napakahirap. Dahil yung Land Use Act will tell you ano ba talaga, ilan porsyento ng lupa ang dapat gamitin sa farming, ilan porsyento ang dapat sa industry, ilan porsyento ang dapat sa housing. Eh syempre dahil napakaraming interest groups, ang hirap ipasa as a law, di ba? So, pero importante yun eh. Kasi yung question na lang na ilang porsyento ng lupa natin ang para sa farming, which is needed, di ba? Question mark pa yun eh.
Mm-mm.
So sana ito isa. And of course, mga amendments to the oil deregulation law na sana makatulong sa pagbaba talaga ng presyo ng electricity.
Okay, so let's focus on those two. Number one, agriculture. Clearly, it's the president's priority. He's taken the bull by the horn, so to speak, and he is overseeing agriculture. He's now agriculture secretary.
Yes.
But for example, ayuda po ba ang solusyon? Because ang tanong ng ilan, wasn't the rice tariffication law supposed to solve that? Right? Profits coming from the rice tariffication law was supposed to support and actually finance farmers affected by it.
Yes, that was the intent of the rice tariffication law. But again, the problem was in the execution.
Okay.
I remember in many hearings, talagang we were very frustrated sa sobrang bagal ng pagbagsak ng pera. And then naabutan na ng pandemic. And therefore, kung anong ayudang ibibigay mo under a rice tariffication law, it's not na intended to be proactive to change the way farmers farm, but rather to help them address the pandemic. So, hindi na overtaken by events tayo, di ba? But right now, iba na yung ano, yung mode natin, economic recovery. Eh, ang importanteng ayuda, tingin ko at this point in time, Karen, is on the production side. Para sa mga suppliers, para sa mga maliliit na farmers.
And you're talking about 2023, not 2022.
Well,
2023. What are you, anong topic na to? Are we talking about the next six months?
This is really in general. Because at this point in time, even under the 2022 budget, may ganun namang available na flexibilities. Kasi nandun naman yung mga line items. It's really just a matter of execution. Mm-mm. But of course, ang pinag-uusapan kasi natin is the 2023 budget. So baka pwedeng dun na talaga ma-articulate kung ano yung magiging priorities.
Okay. Now, Congresswoman, Agriculture Secretary William Dar, I remembered, he advocated that, he was actually lobbying that the budget for agri be increased to something like 260 billion pesos, if you remember, for 2022. And what was approved, he said, was something like 80 to 90 billion, if my memory serves me correctly. So are you seeing that with the upcoming deliberations by the end of the year, should there be more focus? Should some agencies be stripped of the budget because they're not able to spend it, frankly, and move at least 200 billion to agri? That would be a big structural change.
Karen, that is the endeavor year in, year out. When we do the budget deliberations, talagang yun yung purpose. Maghahanap ka talaga ng mga underutilized or unutilized funds across agencies so that you can actually transfer those to agencies that are more efficient in spending and at the same time, greater needs, di ba? So yun ang ginagawa every year. Pero ang limited ng pwedeng gawin eh because again, babalik ako dun sa sinabi ko earlier, there's little time spent on monitoring budget execution. Mm. So by the time they come to Congress for approval, parang kumbaga nakakasa na siya. It's very difficult to make changes, Karen. Kahit ano mong sobrang mali, ang hirap talaga.
Yun nga. Kasi ang tanong ng ilan is, we often talk about agriculture, but do we as a country, do we put our money where our mouth is? Sabi ni Secretary Darnon, he described the agriculture sector that Mr. Marcos will be inheriting, President Marcos, as naghihingalo. Those were his words. So the only way to really improve it, if we're saying this is the focus, is to really dramatically change the budget of agri.
It's the budget and at the same time, structural reforms. Kasama dyan yung land ownership. Eh. Kasi maraming constraints on how much land you can own and how much land you can sell, etc. So meron tayong mga ibang magsasaka na meron pang land holdings na sa totoo lang, wala na silang interest sa pag-farm. I'm not saying lahat, ha, pero meron mga ganun situations.
Yes,
dapat payagan ng ibenta. Kaya lang may mga constraints on those things. Mm-mm. So therefore, hindi rin tayo maka achieve na tinatawag na optimal size of farms. Kasi merong optimal size of farms, you cannot be too small dahil lugi ka, di ba? Kaya lang ang problema.
Which is the situation today.
Yes,
many of them are too small.
Correct. Napakaliit ng average farm size. So
yes,
kailangan siyang makonsolidate. But the process of consolidation, maraming balakid katulad ng mga ibang laws, regulations, etc. Ito yung sinasabi natin, Karen, na kailangan natin ayusin itong mga structural problems na to, particularly sa land.
Oo. Now, the next one you mentioned that was very important that you'd like to hear in the sauna, other than agri, is of course the price of oil. Let's talk about that. You do have, I think it was Party List Representative Mikey Romero, who suggested the return of the Oil Price Stabilization Fund, which was actually implemented during the late President Ferdinand Marcos's time, his father. I think that was in 1984. Frankly speaking, Congresswoman Kimbo, is that even possible at this point, or is that outdated?
Well, this is just my point of view, and with all due respect to Kong Mikey, I really find this it's a quite an archaic concept. Okay. Ang hirap kasi sa OPSF is the assumption is that government knows the correct price and therefore will intervene to achieve that correct price. But that's a very difficult assumption to make kasi it requires government being all-knowing, having all that information, and again, operating at the right size and therefore being very efficient. So maraming assumptions na hindi eh. So malamang sa malamang, magkakamali tayo sa pag-set ng price. Mm. Baka masobrahan sa pag-procure o masyadong konti ang pre-procure, hindi mo rin ma-attain yung price na gusto mong i-target. Mm-hmm. So ang sa akin, just allow market forces to work. But then in a situation as in today where there are external shocks like the Russian-Ukraine war, external shock yun eh. Mm-hmm. Wala kang, very little lang magagawa mo because napakaliit ng ekonomiya ng Pilipinas to influence world events, right? So, ang tingin ko, dapat in the shortest run, ang kulit ko, pero ayudahan dapat ang mga affected. You need to address the effects of this external shock and then think about the medium run on what you can do so that you can actually reduce the cost of electricity in particular.
Okay. All right. Now, tourism is also one of the pillars of this administration. And we've seen many countries, actually, wherein tourism is the backbone of their economy. So where would you want tourism to go in the next 6 years, with no less than President Marcos giving priority to tourism?
I think the most important is the first year, meaning this year and next year. Kasi right now, we are transitioning. Right now, travel is very difficult because of COVID.
So travel to the Philippines or travel abroad?
All around the world. Okay. It's very difficult because iba-iba, di ba? So maraming countries ang hindi na nagma-mask, etc. Mm-hmm. So talagang aasahan mo talaga yung transmission ng COVID. Mm-hmm. And so in a situation where ang ating hospital sector ay hindi masyadong equipped, we only have 5 beds per 10,000 population. And that's the smallest in the entire ASEAN. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Ang hirap tuloy na makapaghikayat ng foreign travelers kapag alam nila na yung situation dito sa Pilipinas ay ganon, di ba? So can you imagine, parang if I'm going to travel to the Philippines, okay, what's going to happen if I get sick? Meron bang enough hospital beds? So tingin ko that's the first, most important, kumbaga yun yung hump, if we're able to actually adopt a policy na with respect to masking, with respect to yung all of these forms that you need to fill up when you enter the Philippines, yung testing requirements, etc. Medyo strict pa rin tayo, Karen. Yung America, wala na.
It's not like that in other countries at all.
Yes, absolutely. So, tingin ko yun yung first pinaka-important step na kailangan gawin ng DOT to under a COVID world. What would be the best minimum health standards to adapt and to implement, ha? Kasi ang hirap, di ba? Like if you fill up the One Health Pass, hindi ka makago through, ang daming mga questions hindi na necessary, bakit ka hinihinga ng credit card details, etc. etc. There are things like those na nakaka-turn off sa isang traveler. So maraming foreigners kasi gigil na mag-travel at namimili din sila base sa health protocols.
So just quickly with that, how would you help the tourism industry rebound. Number one, you said you have to actually streamline and make it easy for foreign travelers. Because, for example, in Spain, it's quite clear that you just wear a mask inside the train, inside the taxi, but you're not mandated to wear a mask anywhere else. So it's very clear to everyone. In the Philippines, we're still wearing masks outside, even in open air spaces. Where do you stand on that, Congresswoman?
I will go back to the health sector capacity. Yeah. So when you travel to the US, panatag ang loob mo eh, because iniisip mo, hindi na balik kasi palagay ko there would be enough hospital beds. Dito kasi hindi eh. So tingin ko yun ang kailangan gawin ng ating Madam Secretary, baka dapat mas makapag-dialogue siya, particularly with the DOH, to find out ano bang pwedeng gawin, anong mga pwedeng i-push na mga health facilities, anong strengthening ang kailangan. Because right now, talaga, that's the biggest obstacle.
Oo.
It's not even infrastructure, etc. It's really the health protocols.
All right. Speaking of health, and this is my last question, the role of PPPs in this administration, because no less than NEDA has said on Head Start, he would like to have more PPPs in this administration that would actually help solve the needs of the country in terms of infrastructure. What kind of PPPs would you like to see that would actually help the economy rebound?
Well, you know, as far as I know, si Secretary RC is really a champion of PPP. And for good reason, during the pandemic, di ba, ang talagang nagtawid sa atin is really the private sector. Di ba? Maraming situations where hirap ang gobyerno mag-procure halimbawa ng bakuna. And ang nagtawid talaga sa atin is the private sector. So that's a simple example. But clearly, there's a lot of willingness and energy that the private sector can really offer. Not to mention good ideas, di ba? So, and tingin ko, dapat ang wag ilimit ang application ng PPP. As in other countries, minsan magagulat ka kung anong application ng PPP sa iba't ibang bansa. Sa akin, as wide as possible na application ng PPP, the better. But I think at this point in time, ang pinaka-problema talaga is yung in the nuts and bolts, yung in writing out the contracts, etc., etc. So sana ma-address na yon kaagad, because anyway, once you're able to do a couple, templated na yon lahat. So tingin ko we really need just to go over the hump, birth pains lang, and tingin ko with a secretary like Sec RC, palagay ko we can be hopeful na marami tayong PPP projects in the next 6 years.
Okay. Are you seeing yourself chairing a committee for the 19th Congress, Congresswoman?
Karen, no. Palagay ko no congressman will answer a question like that. Hindi pa namin alam kung ano mangyayari sa amin. I was happy with the minority in the last 3 years. I still don't know yet kung saan ako. Tiwala na lang kay incoming Speaker Martin kung saan niya kami ilalagay. Sana in a position where we can best be of use to our country.
All right. Well said. Thank you so much. As always, it's a pleasure to speak with you. Very insightful. You take care, Congresswoman Stella Kimbo. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen.